Sharon Gill, G-I-L-L. They have a large website called 21stcr.org, and they're from Tennessee, and we've known Sharon and Dan for many years when they presented their website some years back. And so Dan is here to give us a word of encouragement, whether it goes for 5 minutes or 50 minutes, hour and a half, doesn't matter. Whatever Dan has on his heart, I'd love you to hear that. So Dan, would you come and speak to us and tell us what you think this morning?
Well, it is just an honor to be here this morning, and it is our pleasure to have the opportunity to stop and to spend a little time with you folks, whom we hold in our hearts all the time, and thank you very much. And great to be able to say just a few words. I don't want to interfere with your important studies and lessons that you have ongoing. That's exciting. But I would say hello from Sharon and I, and from our folks back in Tennessee, in the Nashville area. We have a fellowship there of folks who also would love all of y'all, any of you that they have not met. We get to say that in Tennessee, all of y'all. Do y'all say that in Georgia, I suppose?
We're learning it from you, sir.
Oh, okay. It's very important to get that right. But it's so good to be here and among such good friends, and to be able to say hello to all of you who may be listening in out there or watching. Some of you I probably know. Some of you may know me and Sharon, but. And then there are others that I hope to come to know in the future, and look forward to that at the conferences. And do by all means come to the conferences when you can. It's great to get together with other fellow like believers and to be able to talk about things and share our experiences and our understanding. It's great. So we're just happy today to be here, happy about these wonderful truths and the beautiful understandings that God has been so kind to share with us. Mm-hmm. And we love those things and care about them. And I say this, sometimes I think we worry a little too much about the moment we live in, the end time and the difficulties of the time. And I understand all that. And we worry too a bit about the future and what's about to happen. But I've come to not be drawn too much in that direction. It may all be happening, and there are certainly difficult and unhappy things in the future. I'm sure of that. But I don't worry too much about that. Instead, I'm looking at our day and our time and saying, wow, look what beautiful opportunities we have today. And so I don't want to worry too much about the future or trade off the present for that. But instead say, wow, what great opportunities we have to come together, to share in our fellowship and our love of one another, and our love of God and His Word. This is a great opportunity, and great opportunities we have to share our faith with people out there, many of you out there who may not even know personally, and yet, you're able to be a part of us, and we a part of you through these wonderful things. This is a great day. It's a great time to be alive. And when I wake up in the morning, instead of worrying about, oh, it's terrible, and I'm sure that's true. Yeah. There are terrible things, and certainly there are. But I instead like to get up in the mornings and think, hey, what a beautiful, wonderful day this is. What an opportunity, what freedoms we have. Most of us enjoy the freedom of reading our Bibles and concluding for ourselves nowadays what that right understanding would be of God and His Son and His Kingdom and these beautiful things. And that's a wonderful thing and a wonderful opportunity, privilege that we have. And to share with one another, for goodness sakes. And probably most of us can do all of these things without fear that the constabulary is going to come along and knock down our door and want to interfere with our faith and interfere with the things that we have and love in God. In the past, There are those of our ilk, our Christian friends of the past, who've not had that privilege. We do. So when you get up in the morning, one thing you might always say, no matter what the day may hold, no matter what tomorrow holds, right now it's a beautiful, wonderful opportunity to know God and His Son, John 17 and 3, and through them to have this great hope of eternal, aeonian life. Think about that. So there's a lot in our favor, folks. We have a lot going for us. And I know that we will be tried at times and we will be tested at times. That doesn't come from God. He doesn't personally want to come and test us out in that sense exactly. Most of that comes from our own selves and living in this life. Tests come. And they're going to come whether you knew God or not. You're going to have troubles. You know this. And but I think it's important that we realize that, yeah, we will be tested. Which one of us will not run into trials or troubles or temptations or tests along the way? All of us will. All of us have. And we will probably again. You say, well, that's terrible. Yeah, but that's the reality. But the good side of it is, again, that Paul says, you know, God cares about us. And whatever happens, He will not allow us to be tested. He won't let the tests that come against us exceed what we can handle with His help. So we're gonna win in every test. We're gonna win. So I was I will read this scripture and then I'll just sit down. But I just happened to be thinking about Hebrews the 10th chapter, and we love this writer of Hebrews and read. You know how exciting it must be that. Sometimes I think we feel alone out there, or we don't have a lot of folks around us and all. But in a way, there were lots of folks, I think, in New Testament times that probably had similar circumstances. They didn't always have community and fellowship that much. But you know, I was thinking what a great pleasure it must have been, how exciting, when in New Testament times, the community, whoever they were, would get a letter from Paul or Peter or someone else, and how exciting it would be to gather everybody together and read the letter and say, look at this, isn't this wonderful, we have this. Well, we have these letters.
Yes.
We've got them too. Mm-hmm. Isn't that exciting? Mm-hmm. So we shouldn't just look at these things and say, oh, well, we have a, you know, this is a book and it's really very interesting and we want to get it right, and we do. Because of the value of these things. We would want to get such wonderful things wrong. But I think we should be able to come together or think or gather and watch, as some of you are doing here today. But come and watch and say, hey, we're going to read some of those letters, aren't we? We're going to, hey, let's get into this. So, and you're doing this. Luke's writing today. Isn't that wonderful? But... So, and these things encourage us and strengthen us and help us and will get us through when we are tried or tested. We will be, it's just a fact. I have been, will be again, probably. But Jesus Himself was tested. Jesus Himself was tried. And for those of us who are of our understanding, we believe that that trial and testing was for real. It's kind of hard when you think that Jesus is God Almighty, that He was really being tested. Oh yeah, that's a tough one, right? So God Almighty was being tested in Luke 4 and Matthew 4. But we all will be tested. He was. But I like this. Fear not. So the writer of Hebrews says in the 10th chapter in verse 35, therefore do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. Mm-hmm. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay, but my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. So we don't want to be those who would shrink back. We don't want to come against the problem and think, oh, I can't beat this. Yes, we can. We can. With the wisdom of the Word of God and the help of the presence of God in our lives. Verse 39, but we are not of those who shrink back and who are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. I guess my thought today is, sometimes out there it is difficult. Sometimes we feel alone. Sometimes we come up against trials and things that are tough. That's why they call them trials. But there is nothing that we cannot win in by the grace and mercies of God and by His Word. So, and what is, there is a great recompense of reward, the King James says. There's a great reward. That's what we're into. It's not just about technically wanting to get things right. We do want things right, as Anthony said. That's very important. But on the other hand, it goes even beyond that. There's an end to all this, a purpose. And the purpose is that we indeed receive this great inheritance that we inherit with our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 8:17. We're joint heirs with Him. And if we suffer with Him, we also shall reign with Him. What do you think? Wow. So that's what we're really all about here. And so sometimes it may be a little tough for us. It does happen. I would suggest most days I wake up and think it's not as tough for me as it was for a lot of the folks back there. Yes. You think about it. They were going through really rough and difficult times. And on my worst days, most of them are not as tough as some of the things that our brothers and sisters faced in New Testament times, for example, and in the old scriptures as well. So God is with us. We are blessed. We have great advantages. It's a great time to be alive. It's a great time to share our message and our thoughts. You know, all they can do is throw words at you nowadays. They can't do much usually, right? So it's okay. So it is a great time, it's a great day, and we're blessed to be here with all of y'all today. And so blessings to everyone. Be of good cheer, hang in there. There is a great reward attached to the things that we do. Never forget that. There's a purpose to this, there's an end to it. And that is that hope we have of that inheritance of life to come. So we love you all. God bless you all. If you're in Nashville, come and see us. You can look up the website, Higher Ground Church. It's HGCN, Higher Ground Church Nashville, .org. Thank you. Anyway, you can go there and find us. So if you're ever in the Nashville area coming through, please stop and see us. You'll find out there are people there who love you.
Indeed you will.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Oh, you're on top of it. Okay. We mentioned a particular need last Sunday, and Barbara will follow up on that point now.
Yes, just I wanted to say a word about Tracy Zykovich and make you aware of a financial need. Tracy and her husband, Stefan, and three children are living in a 300-square-foot log cabin in Minnesota. As I understand it, there's not even room to get the refrigerator inside, and Tracy is cooking on a hot plate. They are building an addition themselves, but they really need some help with the building materials. Tracy is most definitely one of us, a one God believer. She spent about 20 years in Russia as a missionary, and she continues to help and support the Russian work. She also serves on the LHI Missions Board. She runs a business from their cabin, as well as homeschooling three children and teaching the faith to others. Currently, Stefan is looking for work. Tracy and the family also run a therapeutic horse farm to help physically and mentally challenged children. So, we just ask that you might consider joining with us in helping this family get their addition finished before winter really sets in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. And one important factor in this is that Tracy's trapped in a sense that if you've spent 20 years in Russia, you have no credit history. And so that prevents her from getting the sort of perks that, that we can get. She has a GoFundMe page, GoFundMe/healinghooves.com, or she's, I think they take a little percentage themselves, so if you wanted to give a personal check to Tracy, that, that would also be very, very much appreciated. Tracy's very much loved by us for her stand. She is a truth warrior.
Okay.
Anybody have anything to add?
She's got 5 children? Three children.
Yeah.
Okay. Any comments so far out there?
This is good. Thank God for Dan. Amen. Yeah. Needed to hear this reminder this morning.
Good. Excellent. You got several computers at work out there?
Yes, sir.
You know?
They're all firing.
Okay. We are in the Gospel of Luke. Actually, we forgot to do our Shema thing. Do you want to show them that, sir?
Yeah. Okay.
We recited the Shema today. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And some of you may have seen this. I don't know if you can see that out there on the camera.
I don't know the camera.
But can you read that? Hold up your hand in your local home if you can read what that says. You're either familiar, you say, oh, I've seen that before, there's something new, or you're perplexed. What is that word there?
You have to focus on the dark.
Focus on the dark rather than the light. What do you see? Hold it in an angle slide. Yeah. Yes. And so you're all saying, well, big deal, that's it. It's obviously Jesus. Or you're saying, I have no idea what
maybe
that is.
It's just right. A bunch of sticks.
So it's a fun thing because it depends on what your brain is saying. If you're looking at the white, the light sticks, you're seeing nonsense. If you're looking at the dark, you're seeing the word Jesus. You have to learn to do that.
I'm not sure you
have. Okay.
Okay, now Sarah then.
If you can see that.
Thought, if you can do that, how about the Shema? Well, there it is. That's quite good. I'm the one that does the sticks and cutting the sticks outside in the workshop there, so I'm a little worried about this. I'll have to do some curvy stuff there. That's probably the best thing.
I'll try. Shave it.
So we shave it off. Yes. Now that is the famous Shema, which in Hebrew means listen, pay attention, don't miss this one. Talk to your children about it when you get up in the morning, when you go to lunch, when you go to bed in the evening. That's what you mustn't forget, so we can engage that conversation.
$9.99?
What are you? Is this a,
we haven't.
2 for 1? What is the deal here?
We're not selling them yet.
Our conference then will be the 25th annual, what's been called the Theological Conference, rather a daunting title. It's not a learned thing, splitting hairs over Greek words, heaven forbid. It's a conference of one God believers, and that's on April the 28th of this coming year, God willing. April the 28th. And that will be at the Calvin Center close to Fayetteville in Georgia, where we can provide transportation from the airport for any who come. Some will even come from abroad. We know families coming from
Switzerland.
And it's an exciting time, probably roughly 100 people there. So mark that on your calendar if you'd like a break. Come and meet some fellow One God, Kingdom of God believers. So Dan was exhorting us. I think it's a great point. You know, that you have actually unprecedented opportunities. Back in the 1600s, there was a schoolmaster, John Biddle, who got the truth about one God. He was teaching scripture in a school. He was the headmaster, eventually, of a school in Gloucestershire. And he happened upon the one God truth. It cost him his life. They passed a law of parliament against him. And he died, eventually, in prison. We are unlikely to suffer that right now. This is amazing. There's something supernatural going on here in terms of truth. There's a devil. There is a devil, not you, not human nature. There's an external devil who is hopping mad, as we say in England, against anybody getting the truth. He doesn't want you to get the truth. So this John Biddle died in prison. And you know of Michael Servetus. Again, get your young people to read the book. Out of the Flames is one of the books. Out of the Flames. Michael Servetus. story, tragic story. You weep when you read this. They burned him at the stake for precisely what we're saying here. They took him out. John Calvin leading the bunch here. That's a very cruel thing to do. John Calvin was leading the pack against Michael Servetus, a brilliant geographer, medical person, Bible student, very brilliant person, who wrote against the errors of the Trinity, and Calvin was responsible for having him burned at the stake, and they ensured that the wood there was particularly green, so it would burn slowly. And they walked him out, I'm just imagining this, there was a date on the calendar when they walked him out to that terrible event. And the mayor tried to plead with him, and the mayor said, if you will just say, I believe in the eternal Son of God, we can spare you. And he said, I believe in the Son of the eternal God. I don't believe in the eternal Son. For that he died. It took about half an hour, 35 minutes, before the flames caught up with him. We're not talking jokes here. We're talking real life here. Now, we're dealing with a number of ex-Jehovah's Witnesses too across the world. There are about 5,000 of them active at the present time. And when they become aware of the fact that Jesus was not an angel, when you point out that in Hebrews chapter 1 it says twice, to which of the angels did God ever, ever, ever say, sit at my right hand? None. The answer is a resounding no, none. Then later in the chapter it says, to which of the angels did God ever say, you're my son, today I've begotten you. Today I've begotten you. The answer is absolutely not. That writer is coming hard against the Jehovah's Witness movement there. And when they get to see that, and there are some out there listening with us today, that can be very troublesome because they get persecuted by the movement. They get told that they're apostates now. And even in a husband and wife situation, one gets it, one doesn't, they won't talk to each other. This is an awful thing. So ministry is not about arguing Bible words. We're talking about lives here. This is what we're talking about. I love your point about the great reward. You had the King James Version there, which is very telling. A lot of the King James language is memorable. Many of us will be even brought up on it, but a great recompense and reward there. Remind me of Colossians 3:24. Let's ask Barbara to read Colossians 3:24 in her paraphrase version. What do you have there? Colossians 3:24. Along with what Dan read from Hebrews, exactly the same point.
Remember that the Lord will give you an inheritance as your reward, and the master you are serving is Christ.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You're serving the Lord Messiah. It's an unusual expression, the Lord Messiah. Not the Lord God, you're serving him too, but you're serving the Lord Messiah. And you're going to get the reward of the inheritance or possession. You're going to possess the world and rule the world with Jesus. I mean, is that something to get excited about? I think so. All Americans, particularly with this huge election event, they're trying to fix everything, aren't they? We all know, who can fix the world? Well, I think it's Donald Trump, I think it's Rubio, etc. Wait a minute, you've overlooked the fact that Jesus and you are going to fix the world. So what sort of people should you be today? Do we want corrupt people in that future government? Heaven forbid, let's not do that. You are candidates for royal office. In the Church of England, if I learned anything, which is very little, maybe I wasn't listening, maybe the clergy were telling me I wasn't listening carefully, but I vaguely knew that if I was good, doing what I was supposed to do, which I certainly did not always do, and which of us thinks they always got it right? We didn't get it right, but we were told we would go to heaven and play a harp on a cloud eventually. That is the opposite of the biblical hope. Now, why is hope important? Along with Colossians 3:24, the reward of the inheritance. That's what you get. You're serving the Lord Messiah, and you get the reward of the inheritance. Along with that, Colossians 1, 4, and 5, these are memory verses, these are verses to talk about across the coffee table. Colossians 1, 4 and 5. Let's see what Barbara's paraphrase version says there. Colossians chapter 1, if you read that for us. What does that say? 1, 4 and 5.
For we have heard that you trust in Christ Jesus and that you love all of God's people. You do this because you are looking forward to the joy of... Oh, you will want to hear this. I'm sorry.
Joy of heaven. What does it say?
You are looking forward to the joys of heaven.
That's where paraphrases are. Disaster.
Erase.
Erase that. Okay.
Because
good.
Of the hope right. up for you in heaven,
right.
of which you previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel.
Ah. Now she's reading the New American Standard Version, which is right there. That gospel of the kingdom contained a hope. It's because of that hope, because of... you're getting your love and your faith. So if you've got a congregation that isn't very loving and faithful, perhaps they haven't any idea what the hope is. So work on that verse. That's great. It's laid up for you in heaven, because all the great things of the future are stored up with God in heaven, ready to be revealed at the second coming and given to you then. So that's all that is. But of course, they went berserk and read their heavenly stuff into it. So paraphrases are the good news and bad news. Right? All translation is commentary. You realize that. No translator is without bias. The art is to try to be with as little bias as you can. So they read their stuff into the Bible. NASV is a good translation. My colleague Sam is supposed to mention my own translation occasionally. These are being sold at Amazon. One God, the Father, One Man, Messiah translation. I've tried to get some of these truths into that commentary on the New Testament. Okay, so we're back then. We'll do a little bit of work on Luke chapter 9, huge long chapter. And then, if we've got a bit of time at the end here, we'll talk about eternal generation. What does it mean that your friends believe in those churches that there is a God the Son who is eternally generated? What does that really mean? And can you help show them that it really doesn't mean anything? And that's what they're coming to themselves. So we might be, I think, very positive with Dan, we might be on the brink of a huge revolution here, when people are going to say, wait a minute, what am I getting into? This doesn't make any sense. Let's have a revolution. So I'm hoping for that. This is chapter 9 of Luke, and we had done the feeding of the many there in verse 17, ending there. And then in verse 18, the great question, who do you say that I am, right? Oh, that's a doctrinal question. Let's not do doctrine. Let's just do Christian living. No, this is a doctrinal. Of course it's a doctrinal question. It's all doctrine. It's all teaching. The important thing is, do you know who Jesus is? If you don't, you might get the wrong Jesus, and that would be fatal. So let's not do that. And of course the answer was, Peter says, you're the Christ of God, the Messiah of God, the Messiah of God. The parallel in Matthew 16 says, you are the Messiah, the Son of God, of the living God, right? You read all three parallels and they all complement each other. But why didn't Peter say, you're God? We all know that, you're God. Come on, you're God. We know you're God. Well, that's just absurd. It's like saying, what sort of computer did Paul have? He didn't have one. Come on, let's get real historically. We all know, and I can show you from the best writers today, they know that the Jews believed in one God. Jesus was a Jew, and they believed in the Messiah of God. And if you have a God, you aren't God. So the Christ of God means you have a God. You're the Christ of God. To say you are God is just really incomprehensible. It makes not the slightest sense. Okay, so he warned them then. He didn't want the television cameras right there then, right? There was a time to go out and preach this to the world, but at this particular juncture, that would have gotten them all killed probably immediately anyway, and that wasn't the right time for that to happen. And then he adds this astonishing thing in 22, the Son of Man is himself. That's the capital H, capital M, human being. Jesus keeps saying, I'm the human being. You get it? I'm not God, I'm the human being, out of Daniel 7. He keeps stressing that. And this human being is going to have to suffer many things, be rejected by the church establishment, the elders and the chief priests and scribes. The scribes are the professional scholars. They did it for a living. They did their Bible study for a living. Many of them. And then be killed. What? Come on, Jesus. You're supposed to rule the world. You see the reaction here? This is a shocking thing. Well, they knew the Messiah was going to take charge of the world and rule from Jerusalem. And now you say, I'm going to get killed? You must be crazy. This is a terrible shock. And raised up on the third day. That's Sunday. Died on Friday. Rose on Sunday. The third day. It's the third day from Sunday, counting back to Friday. And then he was saying to them, if you want to come up to me, be my disciple, and deny yourself, take up your cross daily. That's the other side of Dan's coin this morning. I'm entirely with Dan, all the hope we can get, and the positive side. But there is this downside of it, if you like, take up your cross necessarily daily, if necessary, because Jesus suffered, and you have to suffer for my sake. Down in 26, he talks about being ashamed of his words. Isn't that fascinating? We've been reading quotes on Sunday which show that the system out there doesn't really believe in the words of Jesus. Just as long as you believe he died and rose, it's fine. No, no. The words of Jesus are what defines him. So you have to take up your cross, not be ashamed of the words of Christ. And then when he comes in his glory, you notice he immediately refers to the second coming here. And so I'm going to die. He quickly tells them his coming and his glory in verse 26. And then we have this amazing vision. You see the connection there? That was a bad day for them when they heard the Messiah is going to die. You need an encouragement. If you notice in your life sometimes something goes wrong, you get something that happens that brightens your day a little bit. So after 8 days, after these sayings, the connection to verse 28 with verse 22, exactly 8 days after that particular saying, they have a vision of the second coming. We went through 2 Peter 1, right? You show your friends in 2 Peter 1 that Peter says, when we were on the mountain with him, we heard that voice and we saw, Peter says, the parousia, the second coming, one single second coming, the arrival of the Son of God. We saw it. This is the uplifting moment after the discouraging one, right? Because that was a huge shock. Okay, he's going to come back. All of that is quite clear. The critics of the Bible get that all wrong. They say, oh, poor old Jesus got it wrong. See, the second coming didn't happen in 8 days, so he was a false prophet. That's absurd. All you do is read 2 Peter chapter 1, where Peter explains exactly what happened. He says, we saw the parousia, that's the good word for you to know, the second coming. Not an invisible second coming in 1914. Great respect to our Jehovah's Witness friends. That's just fundamentally wrong. Jesus did not come back in 1914. Actually, the world wars broke. The very opposite, right? That's just fundamentally wrong. Let's not blame them. God is their judge and so on. But that's fundamentally wrong. The parousia is the future, one single visible event. And they had a vision of it. They saw Moses representing the law and Elijah representing the prophets, standing there talking to Jesus with glorified bodies. Isn't that marvelous? It was a vision. It actually says in Matthew's version, it calls it an orama. As in the word panoramic, right? Panoramic, an orama. It was a vision, it wasn't actuality. Well, the NIV is very feeble, the translation says, don't tell anybody what you saw. Excuse me? Don't tell anybody the vision you had of the second coming, right? So they lost that in the translation. Anyway, that was fun stuff. They appeared in glory in verse 31, and he talked about his departure, we're back to his death now, his departing from this life, which was about to happen, in Jerusalem.
Anthony?
Yes.
Sir.
Comment.
Verse 26, it says, when he comes in his glory.
Yes.
So the Son has a glory.
Yes.
And in the glory of the Father.
Yes.
The Father's glory.
Yes.
And of the holy angels.
Yes.
Are we to understand that as each one has...
Absolutely, yeah. So there's a trinity, got it? You've got the angels and God and Jesus. Oh, come on. When you put three items together, it doesn't mean they're all God. It doesn't mean all these three are the same. So when you're told to go and baptize into the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Matthew 22, that's what it says. It doesn't mean they're all God.
I was speaking more towards the question about the glory, because in the Old Testament, you know, it says God... He does not give his glory to anyone else.
Of course, he doesn't.
And some Trinitarians or some people use this to say, well, look, Jesus' glory, right? So,
well, that makes the angels God too, then. Right, and you. So he's going to give glory to you. Okay, I'm glad you mentioned it. That's exactly right. When he says, when God says, I don't give my glory to anybody, period, that means, of course, I don't give my unique glory as the one God to anybody else. You have to understand that. It's very easy. But he does give glory. He intends to give glory to the saints. He's given a lot of glory to Jesus. And here you learn the angels are glorious. You remember when angels show up, people are scared out of their wits, aren't they? And what would Mary think when this Gabriel walks into the kitchen? Says, by the way, you're going to have a child. She's not even married properly yet. This is amazing. An angel is a terrifying being. Daniel was shocked. He fell on his face and was exhausted by the experience. So they do have glory. We're going to be like the angels. It says that in Luke 20. We're not angels, not going to be angels, but like the angels in one respect, like the holy angels, by the way, not the fallen angels, not talking about Satan, that's a different category. But we're going to have shining faces like the angels. So that's a great point.
Question from Michelle about, could you explain the following verse?
Yeah.
There are some standing here who will not experience that before they see the kingdom of God.
Well, that's the transfiguration we went into last week. It's a great question. There are some standing here who before they die, in fact within 8 days, are going to see this kingdom. There are some right in front of him, Peter and James and the others, right there. You're actually going to see this kingdom before you die. Well, that's amazing. That puts a time limit. It was. It was a vision of the kingdom. 2 Peter chapter 1 explains it. It says, we saw the parousia. We saw the second coming. We heard the voice, which we're going to read about here in this context. Listen to my son. Remember that in verse 35 there? In verse 34, while Jesus was saying this, a cloud formed and began to overshadow them, and they were scared out of their wits. As they entered the cloud, you would be. What an event this was. Then a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my son, my chosen one, my elect one, and you're also elect people, as you know. He's the elect. Listen to him. That's the Shema. Do you hear it? That's the Shema Yisrael. Listen to God, listen to my son. That's very clear. It was a vision of the second coming. 2 Peter chapter 1 explains it in detail. We went through that last week. Wonderful stuff. So that's a good question. So when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. Well, let's argue about the word alone. That's not. Jesus was alone. God is alone. Alone. All one. Alone. Only means onely. Have you ever thought of that? Only is the word onely. Of course. This was never argued about until the church fathers got to mess with their Greek philosophy, and the whole thing is chaos now. 30,000 denominations. It wasn't meant to be that way. So only there was the Son, alone. And then in verse 38, a man from the crowd shouted, saying, teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He's my only son. And Jesus, as you know, had mercy on him. For some reason, the disciples' faith wasn't up to getting rid of that demon. How that works today, I don't exactly know. We're in Africa, we've seen demonic activity. We met a man there who knew our names, and he really did. He knew everybody's name before we told him. It was provable. And we also know that they put jinxes on each other. And we saw in a Bible study, we saw a man go into a fit and a rage right in the middle of the Bible study. He did. We had to restrain him. I've seen some of that. Anyway, the demon left when Jesus operated his faith.
Okay, this is where we cut off last time.
So we can read that around the class and can't see if there are any more questions. 37, let me start with 37, ask Barbara to do 38 I'll do, and then Barbara 39. A man from the crowd shouted, saying, teacher, rabbi, I beg you to look at my son. He's my unique son, my only son.
An evil spirit keeps seizing him, making him scream. It throws him into convulsions so that he foams at the mouth. It is always hitting and injuring him. It hardly ever leaves him alone.
Wow.
I begged your disciples to cast it out, and they could not.
Jesus said, you unbelieving and corrupt people, how long do I have to remain here with you and put up with you? Bring your son here.
42.
And as he was yet, a coming, the devil threw him down and tear him, and Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit and healed the child and delivered him again to his father.
43.
Everyone was amazed at this demonstration of God's power. However, even though everyone was astonished by all he did, Jesus warned his disciples, listen carefully to what I am telling you. The Son of Man is about to be betrayed into the hands of men.
45.
But they did not understand this saying, and it was concealed from them, so that they might not perceive it. And they were afraid to ask him about this saying.
Yep. That's pretty amazing. This is the second declaration of his coming death, right? The first one you had in verse 22, number one. Now comes the second one in verse 43, about the death of Jesus. Verse 44 it is, isn't it? Right, key verse for you to remember is Matthew 16:21, in your margin there. Matthew 16:21 is the parallel. Matthew 16:21, he says he began to talk about his death. Matthew 16:21. That's two-thirds of the way through his ministry. He hadn't said a word about his death. And yet he'd been preaching the gospel. That is fundamentally interesting to your people in evangelical churches. Because they think the gospel is really only about the death and resurrection of Jesus. And you point that out, Matthew 16:21, parallel to the one we just read in Luke 9:22. the first announcement, for the very first time, said, by the way, now I'm going to die. Well, he's been preaching the gospel continuously. They've been out there preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And then suddenly, he comes with this shocking announcement. That is actually the foundation of the whole Abrahamic movement. They said, this is incredible. What happened to the gospel then? What was that gospel before he said anything about his death and resurrection? That's a question that can change people's lives. It's very, very interesting. So there it is, number two. In the announcement list, there are three of them altogether. Number two is in verse 44, and they didn't get it. But they had been preaching the gospel under his supervision all that time. Of course, it was about the kingdom. They knew what that was. So he announces a second time, they don't get it, and then they get into an argument, heaven forbid. So people argue. Jesus argued with people sometimes, in a nice way, I'm sure, but sometimes rather strongly. Paul argued from dawn till dusk. He did that. He dialogued, it says. He did that. He would go to the marketplace and lobby people. Just go to the marketplace, equivalent to the internet, by the way. There's some marketplace, the internet, and he argued with people. Yes, he did. They love to do that. I hope they did it in a civil way, of course. But they challenge each other's minds to think this through. It's only because you and I have been challenged, isn't it? Kind Christadelphian came to us and said, many years back in 1972, said, well, wait a minute, this God the Son, where are you getting that from? I said, what? You must be kidding. The rock that followed them, I knew about the rock that followed was Jesus. Come on. This idiot here had been deceived. And this kind Christadelphian opened our eyes to that truth. So we all need to be challenged. It's great to be challenged. Then we can do better, think straighter than we did before. Okay, 46. I think we'll read on here. Whose turn to read me? 46. An argument started among them. Which might be the greatest? That's a bit childish, but this is what they argued about. 47, Barbara.
But Jesus knew their thoughts, so he brought a little child to his side and said to them, whoever receives this child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. For the one who is least among all of you, this is the one who is great.
John spoke up, Master, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, mm-hmm. and we tried to stop him because he was not one of us.
And Jesus said unto him, forbid him not, for he that is not against us is for us.
Okay, let's stop right there. Challenging little nuggets of conversation here. They're arguing about who's going to be the greatest, and then he says, let's look at a child. Isn't that one of them? Does that mean then the child is the greatest literally? No, obviously the point is very clear. A child has this open-eyed approach to things, right? You tell the child that the moon is made of cheese, he's going to believe it. A childlike approach to belief is the model for us. The humble child, and whoever receives this child in my name, receives this child then in the sense that somebody preaches Jesus and his teaching to them, receives in my name, representing me, Christ in this case, is receiving me. All right, so I see, the child is the same as Jesus, is that right? Well, yes, in a sense, yes, in a sense, not. Not literally. It's the agency principle, right? The one receives, then he goes on to make that point here. He says, The one who receives me receives God, the one who sent me. So God is Jesus. No, God is the sponsor. Jesus represents God. This is the agency principle. So we do it in class like this. Let's say Sarah sends me out on a job. I am Sarah. I'm not Sarah, but I am Sarah. Can you handle it? I'm not Sarah, but I'm Sarah. If you can handle that, you've got the whole key. That's wonderful. Agency, right? You are as your sponsor. The Jews said that. An agent is as his sponsor's person. You're the same person, quotes, right? It's very wonderful. Wonderful. Jesus is saying that all the time. Of course, that deals with the text in John 20:28, where finally Thomas says to Jesus, my Lord and my God. Oh, there you go. Jesus must be God. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. You've got 1,317 times the Father is God in the New Testament. So now suddenly Thomas gets the point and he says, my Lord Jesus and my God. There you go. Jesus is God. That is very respectful, very silly, because the whole of John's Gospel keeps saying, if you've seen me, you've seen God. Jesus said that. If you've seen me, Jesus, you've seen God. Does it mean he is God? Of course not. So you take them to Genesis 18, and make a note of this one, Genesis 18, and three angels showed up, three men, Genesis 18. Three men showed up, they turned out to be angels. And one of them Not all three. One of them was addressed as Yahweh. Does that mean that angel was Yahweh? Of course not. Yahweh was in heaven. But he's as Yahweh. See, it's exactly the same thing. Jesus is as God to us. Moses was told to be God to Pharaoh. You know that text, right, in Exodus 7. He says to Moses, get out there and be God. What does that mean? You're a member of the tribe? Of course not. Act as God. So we should be acting as God, as Jesus. Doesn't mean we are Jesus, doesn't mean we are God. This has to be taught to the children firmly, and they will never get it wrong. So they shouldn't be arguing about who's the greatest, and the child is the greatest, the servant. Yes.
You talked about the list of these.
Mm.
Where's that? What verse?
Verse 48 at the end.
48.
Yeah.
So the list of these are defined here by Jesus as Christians, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
So would this explain this parable in Matthew 25? If you've done, where it says,
you've done good things to the least,
of these.
Right.
So that's
Christian brothers and sisters. Okay. Yeah, that's a particular judgment for the nations there. If you've treated Christians well, you're doing good. In that unusual scene in Matthew 25.
So the list of these in the Gospels are Christians.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
Just another question. This is for me. Is it just me, or does Jesus sound angry here in verse 41?
Oh, I think he's very upset.
Why is he angry?
Because they're so stupid.
Well,
he's frustrated. He's a human being. Have you ever been frustrated with anybody who doesn't get it? Of course. He has a right to do that. God is frustrated.
Right, so a parent is taking the child that's possessed by a demon.
Right.
And Jesus gets angry that the parent is coming?
No, he gets angry that the disciples' faith is not adequate to the job.
Oh, he's angry at the disciples, not at the subject.
No, of course not.
Yeah.
I see.
No, and that's rather interesting, isn't it? That they should have been able to do better. He has to deal with it. But he's rebuking his own students. Every professor, every parent rebukes their children. And Jesus, if you really want to see Jesus angry, it's in Matthew 23. He is furious with the establishment, right? You miserable people, you snakes and you vipers, and how polite is that? How in the world are you going to escape destruction in hell, he says. Oh yes, God can be very angry, and Jesus reflects God. He's like God. Speaking to God, so he does get frustrated.
Sounds like he's angry with everyone here, though. You unbelieving and corrupt people.
Well, he's broadening it to the whole society was unbelieving, particularly the disciples here. They weren't getting it. They were more responsible than other people. They should know how to do this, right? So I don't know how to deal with any of this. I don't meet obviously demon-possessed people. I sometimes wonder if the demons aren't more active in a subtle way in the West. I don't know how all of that works. But those three occasions, it was on another occasion in Africa too, where we were in a place that had no light, and it was just all candle lit, and we were talking about Messiah, and a lady right here on the right suddenly went, okay, right as I was speaking. I think that was a demon, and the elders came along, bundled her out. We went on. So I'm sure it happens. I'm not a master of that subject because I haven't been involved in that, but yeah. Pretty amazing stuff. So the group, you know, that gets rid of the demons and the devil from the Bible is not doing well at all. I think Jesus would be very frustrated with that. The Christadelphians who say there is no devil, you're the devil. The demons are just diseases. That's just not reasonable. The demons, demonia in Greek, is demons. You can look it up in Webster's. It means a demon. It doesn't mean a human being. And Jesus spoke to the demons, and they spoke to him. You get that out of the text and you're destroying scriptures, like denying the virgin birth, unfortunately. So we have to be very careful we just don't say no to the text. You know, the Bible is a precious book, needs to be treated with care, very care. Okay, so that's that demon text is Luke 4:41. If you want to show your friends Luke 4:41, Jesus spoke to the demons. The demons recognized that he was the Messiah. That's just not true of people in asylums. You go to an asylum today, a mental hospital, you won't find them all recognizing Jesus as Messiah. It's silly. No, they knew who Jesus was. So the demons do exist in God's economy. Okay. That's that part. So where did we get to now?
41.
51. Luke 9:51. Right, here we go. The thing about he who is not against you is with you. And there is a text that says the opposite. Mm-hmm. Which one is that?
11:23.
Thank you. 11:23. I'm marking that. I should have that marked. 11:23. Read that for me, Sarah, please.
He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters.
Okay, so two different situations, right? The one is applicable in one situation. The other truth applies in another situation. But if you're doing God's work, then why should we stop them? On the other hand, if you don't do Jesus' work, you're against him. So you have to compose those two ideas, like the Proverbs, they work together. Now then, in 51, who's going to read 51 for us?
You.
Me? Okay, when the days were approaching for his ascension, he was determined to go to Jerusalem.
He sent messengers ahead to a Samaritan village to prepare for his arrival. But they did not receive him because he was traveling toward Jerusalem.
When James and John saw this, they asked Jesus, "Master, do you want us to call fire down from heaven to burn them up?"
55.
But he turned and rebuked them and said, "You know not what manner of spirit you are of."
56.
Then they proceeded to another village. While they were walking, one man said to Jesus, "I am going to follow you wherever you go."
Okay, that's 57. Can you get 56 easily for us there?
Well, it doesn't have, some texts
okay,
don't have.
Okay, thank you, right. Yeah. Some texts don't have 56. In the NASB, we've got here, "For the Son of Man did not come to destroy man's lives, but to save them," and they went on to another village. So, yes, sir. It's missing in some manuscripts, it's great, you know, fine. I left it out in my translation, apparently I actually had it there, but anyway. This is interesting, isn't it? Do you want us to destroy them? Because that's what, in the Old Testament, was allowed to happen. What was it, the ones who mocked Elijah? Those kids who mocked Elijah? They were destroyed, just like that. In the New Covenant, you don't get the operation of God's executive justice like that. In Moses' time, you are to stone a rebellious child. You can't do that today. You certainly stone adulterers, right? In the New Covenant, we're not doing that. Now, that doesn't mean it isn't a sin. The rebellious child is still guilty of death. And in the kingdom, you will be able to execute that. So let me give you a tough text in Luke 19, where the returning Messiah says, "Bring my enemies in front of me and execute them." Do you hear that? That's Jesus. We don't get many sermons on that, do we? No. Why not? Well, we're very Pollyanna in our approach to the Bible. We've got our select texts, we do these texts, we don't do the others. No, bring my enemies, the adulterers, the fornicators, and any other sin mentioned in the Bible, the children who will not obey their parents, bring them in front of me and execute them. Is it clear? That doesn't get a lot of publicity, that text, does it? It's right there. Our Jesus has to be balanced by all the things he said. So God, then, is a God of justice. He's not going to put up with irrational sexual behavior, let's put it that way, forever. That's going to stop. And it's wise to stop now. He's not going to put up with children who rebel against their parents. That's going to stop. So that needs to be said, I think. Okay, you cannot then call down fire from heaven. It's interesting, they weren't fully with the understanding, were they, these people? They had to learn. They're in the learning process. They're thinking of Elijah, and it was okay for that destruction to happen from Elijah. But at this juncture in the story, there's no question of trying to kill these people. You don't know what kind of spirit you are. That's a good demonstration of what spirit is, right? It's mood, it's atmosphere. It's the sort of thing that you project. You know, you all project a certain spirit. It doesn't mean another person from you. So you say to your friends, "Is the spirit of Elijah a different person from Elijah?" Well, no. Well, is the Spirit of God a different person? Of course not. No, it's your mood, it's your ambiance, your atmosphere, what you project. You know, we talk about a person with a timid spirit or a kind spirit, don't we? That's what exactly it meant here. What sort of mood are we to have to these evil people? And he says, you don't know, you don't understand, you haven't got it right. So they're learning the process. Now, great excitement comes from 57 to 62. Who's going to read 57 for us?
You.
me. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, Jesus, I'm going to follow you wherever you go.
But Jesus replied, foxes have dens to live in and birds have nests, but I, the Son of Man, have no home of my own, not even a place to lay my head.
That's a good translation.
And he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father.
Jesus said, let the dead bury their own dead. You can go and proclaim the gospel of the kingdom of God everywhere.
Good. 61.
Another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go bid them farewell, which are at my home, at my house.
62.
But Jesus said to them, nobody, once he has started plowing and then looks back, it's fit for the kingdom of God.
Yeah, I can see why they don't like sermons on Jesus very much, right? I'd rather stick with Paul. I can twist him into anything I like. I mean, I'm seriously though, this is the Jesus who's still living. Isn't this tough stuff? It's very, very tough. It's uncompromising. But Jesus speaks for God. God then is uncompromising. He wants us to get real, apparently. So this is amazing material. As they were going along the road, somebody out of the crowd says, hey, I'm with you. You know, I'm on board. I love this. I'm great. This is wonderful. Wherever you go, and Jesus warns them. He says, isn't this great? Wonderful. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. No. He said, watch out. I don't have a place to stay, by the way. Now, does that mean that everybody in Christian dispensation is supposed to sell everything they have? No. Because in the epistles, which Dan and I are hoping to do some commentary on that today and tomorrow, you'll find that there are supposed to be rich people in the church, are rich people in the church, as long as they're generous, as long as they're kind with what they have, that's fine. So you're not required then to give up give up your car, come on, sell it, give it up. No, would be rather limiting. But you are prepared, at least, not to have a fixed abode in the case of the human being, capital H, capital B, human being. He doesn't have a place to lay his head.
It's also possible that his harshness here mm-hmm. is based on what 47 says, mm-hmm. that he knew people's thoughts. So maybe this specific particular people asking him this stuff, he knew they weren't serious, maybe?
Well, yes. He's warning us that this is illusionary to imagine this makes you a king right now. It doesn't. Now, in the future, of course, it's all going to be changed. But right now, you have to be prepared to be without resources, apparently. Yeah. I don't know. See, there are lots of good ways you can read all this, lots of applications.
My note says about bury my father. The father had not died. The speaker meant that he was obligated to care for him until he died.
Probably that's right. Rather, it may not be don't go to the funeral even. It probably means let me go and look after my elderly parents. And that's not good enough. I don't think Jesus was politically correct, was he? At all. He'd have been nailed by Fox News immediately for being politically incorrect. So allow the dead... how polite is that? Allow those dead parents, virtually dead parents of yours, to die. Excuse me. That's pretty amazing, right? Allow them to die. You're not obligated to go and look after them in this particular case. But you get out and do something else. He said to them, allow the dead, the spiritual dead, to bury their own dead. Clear, right? They're spiritually dead, they get on with that. But you are to do something else. You go and herald everywhere the kingdom of God. You herald, one of the gospel preaching words. You get your trumpet and you blast this information everywhere. Because that's the only thing that really counts, isn't it? When all said and done, what really counts? Is your place in the kingdom rather than being destroyed. So that's a key verse. Another one said, I'll follow you, Lord, and by Lord, of course, he doesn't mean God, Lord Jesus, Lord Messiah. So the word Lord in the Bible applies to the gardener. When Mary Magdalene showed up after the resurrection of Jesus, she thinks he's the gardener, and she addressed him as Lord. Now, in your Bible, it's probably been fine. She doesn't say Lord, it says Sir. The same word though, Kyrie, Kyrie, Kyrie. It goes for the gardener and it goes for God. You got it? There's place for ambiguity there. The devil loves that. He equivocates on the word Lord. So he's called Lord, so he must be God. No, silly. The gardener was called Lord. It works for the gardener all the way up the scale. In England, we talked about the Lord Mayor. We didn't think the Lord Mayor was God. That's what they're constantly trying to say in churches, that Jesus is Lord, therefore he's God. That doesn't follow at all. So,
just to add to Sarah's notes about how what this might mean to the funeral or whatever.
Yes.
Right. This note says that it could be speaking about the reinterment of the bones that in Judaism, you know, a year after the person died, they went back basically and did another funeral. They gathered the bones and put it in the ossuary, which was this block of a box of cement.
I know that.
So maybe
it's too difficult. Too difficult. I don't know. Speculation. The more easy explanation is, you know, your parents are getting elderly, not just attending a funeral. Who knows?
So it says Jesus could well be rebuking the man for wanting to wait around for as much as a year before making a commitment to follow him.
Yes, I think that's probably very unlikely, but however, it doesn't matter. The point is very clear. You're supposed to put the kingdom in front of everything. Jesus said to him, no one, after putting his hand to the plow, starts the plowing process, and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. So we're looking at candidates and saying, who is fit to take charge of America? It's all about who is fit to rule. The New Testament is about who is fit to be a Christian and fit to rule the world. It's amazing. It makes it rather real to me. I want to read a quote from a Jewish scholar, Klausner, who makes this point so well. Sometimes the Jews do better with the New Testament than the Christians. That's rather amazing. Klausner was very famous. He was a professor of Jewish studies and so on at a big university. He says this, we have reason to believe that Jesus expected the kingdom to be restored to the Jews in the political sense. Yes, that's right. And some of the churches say, oh, your politics was spiritual. Spiritual, I'm not to do that voice, so spiritual. It's all spiritual, which means I don't want to believe it. And then you remind them of Zechariah, who didn't believe what the angel said. He was struck dumb and deaf for 9 months. Watch out. If the text says it, you believe it. So, we have reason to believe that Jesus expected the kingdom to be restored to the Jews in the political sense in italics. Yes. In the first verses of the book of Acts, without any preparation or warning from the context, there suddenly comes this passage, happens to be Acts 1:6. And they said to him, this is after he came back from death, the disciples said to him, they were gathered together, having a meal together, and they asked him, Lord, Kyrie, Lord, Messiah, are you at this time restoring the kingdom to Israel? What? That's a marvelous text. You see that? That doesn't get any sermons out there. I wrote a whole article on this. It was published in the Evangelical Quarterly way back, Howard Marshall. Was kind enough to publish. I showed that all the commentators go crazy on this question. They're so stupid disciples, they actually believe in a political king. Of course they did. It's a wonderful text. And Jesus didn't rebuke them. He said, you idiots, the kingdom is in your heart. Come on. He didn't say that because he was a realist. He understood the kingdom. And so this man got it. This is a Jew. He's an unbeliever in terms of believing Jesus was Messiah. So this verse shows, he says, does not raise any doubt but that Jesus would restore the kingdom to Israel. It was only a question of when. Yes! We had to go to an unbelieving Jew to find that. Isn't that amazing? Ask your pastors to preach on this for several months. I said it to the students, you know, ask about, is he preaching on the kingdom of God? Do they understand the kingdom of God? Do they sound like Jesus? Preach on the kingdom of God. Preach on that text. And I think people will see, will understand the Bible better. Okay, so that takes care of that. We have a few minutes left.
Just some comments.
Oh, some comments, please. Yes, interaction. What have we got?
Oh, Michelle says she appreciates the various explanations about burying the dead.
Yes.
Seems harsh that if his father just died, that he should not mourn or bury him.
That's right.
I understand this passage better now.
Yes.
Just comments on from Tracy. The problem is when Christians think they need to I think she's talking about the kingdom now stuff.
Yeah.
Nowhere are we taught to create peace and kingdom life now. Jesus said to live peacefully. His ultimate peace will be when he comes. So
That's true. You can talk about the kingdom now in terms of the promise of the kingdom, the lifestyle of the kingdom, all that is wonderful. It's a down payment. But they use Luke 17:21 quite irrationally. And the King James of Luke 17:21 says, the kingdom of God is within you. That's almost certainly a mistranslation. Probably he's saying, the kingdom of God, when it comes, will be all over. The sense is probably this. And it's the verse they use to the exclusion of all others, unfortunately. The Pharisees said, when's the kingdom coming? That's a good question. When's the kingdom coming? And he says, it's not coming by watching the moon or rushing off here and there to find it in the wilderness or find it somewhere else. It's not. When the kingdom comes, it will be all over in the midst of you. Probably that's the sense. If that's not the sense, then he means, I'm standing here, I'm the king of the kingdom, and you missed it. I'm the kingdom that's among you. That's possible. It certainly doesn't say the kingdom of God is in your heart. Although it has to be, right? That's fine. But that's not his main point. So it shouldn't be an argument. You can tell your friends that the inheritance of the kingdom is always future. It never says you've inherited the kingdom. So when the kingdom of God comes, you will be ruling the world with Jesus, and all the dead saints will be ruling the world. You can go to Jerusalem. You won't find Jesus on the throne in Palestine. He's not there. It's amazing. Well, the kingdom hasn't come. That's why we're praying, your kingdom come. That's easy. So that's a key. No text says we've inherited the kingdom. We're heirs of the kingdom. But we haven't inherited yet. If we were in the kingdom, inheriting it, then you'd be ruling the world with a rod of iron, Revelation 2:26, right? With Jesus. You want to be like Jesus? He says, just as my Father gave me the right to rule the world, I'm giving it to you. What? This is an amazing Messiah to me. Find him rather exciting. Okay, a word on eternal generation then. It happens that eternal generation is the basis of Trinitarian doctrine, and eternal generation means eternal begetting. That English word to beget, in Greek yenao, it means to cause, to come into existence. It's a good word. We all know about children beginning, don't we? We all understand that, just like we understand food and weather and everything else. Easy. Yanao means to cause, to come into existence. That's what a father manages to do, the creative power of the male. And the same word, yanao, we're using the modern Greek pronunciation, which we do at Atlanta Bible College, yanao also means a mother bearing a child. So yanao has two senses. One is of the father, begetting the child, and the other is of the mother bearing the child. They're both yenao. But the point is, nobody thinks that child already exists. You got it? Nobody thinks the child really exists before the father begets the child. Nobody thinks the child is really born before when the child is still in the womb. And this is not rocket science. But believe me, the church fathers, so-called, turn all this into nonsense. Probably needs to know this. I mean, we're very good at conspiracy theories, you know, real and not real, but the genuine ones. We're very good at analysis. We analyze everything to death now, but nobody bothers to think about this. When you go into a Protestant church, you are committing yourself to the notion of eternal generation. And this is what one of the church fathers said. His name was Origen, O-R-I-G-E-N, heavily philosophical in his training. He says, God cannot generate yanao, bring into existence, in time. Because guess what? God is eternal, so when he says today, he means eternity. I'm quoting the church fathers now. That's not why we're not part of it, but that's what God is not to say today. He's not allowed to say it, because God is eternal. For him, today is forever. See, I think they went mad when they said that. So you're telling what God, you're telling God what he can do. That's crazy, isn't it? There's a famous Psalm 2:7, which says, God speaking, today I have yenao'd my son. I have brought him into existence. Isn't that beautiful? Today, on a given today. That verse is very popular in the New Testament. In 2 Samuel 7, David gets this amazing promise. 2 Samuel 7:14, it says, I, God, will be his father. Not I am his father. 2 Samuel 7:14. I will be his father. Talking about the Messiah. You see, the whole Jewish nation lived under this.
this. This is of the thrill that kept them going. It's clearly in the future. So eternal generation is just impossible as an idea. So here's a sample of where we're going, I think in a great direction. I think Dan's absolutely right to be hopeful. Because if we can get this conversation going with Megan and the others, this should be interesting enough for the lady who does fresh air, you know, to surely talk about this on national public. You think so? Come on. It ought to be very interesting. The Person of Christ by Donald MacLeod, a learned Trinitarian theologian. Eternal generation. The idea of eternal generation, that God cannot do anything today, is everything is eternity, is an inevitable result of the idea of eternal sonship, right? You eternally generate a son. You're talking about eternally generating, period. That's the son, eternally generating. And it figures prominently in the statements of the Nicene Church Fathers. These are these Greek philosophically minded fathers who established the faith post-Bible, right? They're responsible for all of that creedal stuff. However, says Donald MacLeod, DD, it is far from clear what content, if any, we can impart to this content. I translate. We're not sure that it means anything at all. He's right. Come on now, you folks out there, listen carefully. You are yourself saying, we're not sure this means anything. It doesn't mean anything. We'll give it up then. Go to church next Sunday and say, we now renounce the nonsense that we've been talking about. There are many scholars who've said this, by the way. So, I repeat, this statement about eternal generating, it's not clear what content, if any, we can impart to this concept. It is revealed, but it's revealed in a mystery. You're smiling, and millions of people out there are not smiling. It's revealed. But it's not, it's revealed as a mystery. And the writings of the Church Fathers abound in protestations of the inevitable ignorance on this matter. They all say as follows. Athanasius, famous name, really a street fighter at the worst time, anyways, Athanasius. He says, it isn't right to seek to find out how God begets and what is the manner of his begetting. Don't even think about it, don't even go there. Stay away from that. So, on and on, quotes. But my point is that there are a lot of people in the scholarly world who know this is wrong. Can we not admit that we need some reformation? 21st century reformation is right. It doesn't make any sense because we're talking about the difference between Mary having a baby supernaturally and Mary taking a baby in from a pre-existing God the Son, which is really bizarre. Those early church fathers, this should be public information, Justin Martyr, one of them, says, what happened was that God the Son, the second member of what became a triune God later, a second God person, entered the womb from outside, engineered his own begetting. That's just crazy, it's bizarre, it's actually quite disgusting, you think of it. That the God the Son hovered over Mary, reduced himself to, I love this because you always say, you don't mean this. Yes, it's on the books, unfortunately. It's on the books. And so this God the Son reduced himself to a fetus. And he took on human nature from Mary. All that Mary provided was, quote, human nature. What? I got the impression that Mary had a baby, didn't you? Who was a person. All right, so one of the famous quotes, I'll kind of finish with this here. In that system, although they don't preach on it, and nobody even bothers to know, you are to say, Jesus was man, but not a man. Isn't that crazy? Why? Because he's man in a generic sense. He's got human nature added to the personality of really God the Son. You can't have two persons. You can't have God the Son, one person, joining up with another person in the womb, right? It's two persons. That was the error of what they call Nestorianism. Nestorius got that wrong. One of the heresies, they said, that can't be right. It can't be two persons. They said, no, the real person, the subject of this person, is God the Son, who assumes, takes on human nature, impersonal human nature. That's what they say. It's time for us, I think, to give that up.
So that's eternal generation. It doesn't make any sense. And there are books being written, one by Kevin Giles, who says there are 15 leading scholars who say that eternal generation is just completely wrong. So if you read the Christmas so-called stories, it's not that hard. I mean, it was just referred to these passages in Luke where the angel shows up, as you know, Gabriel does. Mary is terrified out of her wits. She's standing there in the kitchen and the bright shining light says, "Hail." That's to say greetings, right? To be careful about the word hail because, you know, it means various things in the South here, where you pronounce it. Greetings. Greetings. You are highly favored. And the Roman Catholics said, it means you are going to give favors. Don't say that. Mary's going to give favors. No, she's not giving favors. That's what they butchered the translation. No. Gabriel said to Mary, you are highly favored by God. You are really blessed. They're going to say, blessed are you among women. You are very special. She's probably 13 years old, 14 years old. And says the Holy Spirit is going to hover over you like a cloud. You know, there's going to be a mysterious event, rather like the Transfiguration. And for that reason precisely, this is Luke 1:35, key verse for you to ponder, Luke 1:35, for that reason precisely, exactly because of this event where the Holy Spirit comes over you, Mary, your child is going to be called the Son of God. Isn't that beautiful? Let's argue about it. Let's not. Again, you remember Zechariah failed to believe what the angel said. That's the father of John the Baptist, right? His wife was probably 65. And she's going to have a child, whatever. Well, I believe that. Well, wait a minute. You're struck dumb for not believing it. If you don't believe what God says, you're calling God a liar. You don't want to do that. So Zechariah struck down for 9 months, can't speak, as we come up with the Bible study, right? Probably couldn't hear, probably couldn't speak, right? A warning. Don't mess with the text. When an angel speaks, you're supposed to believe it. So Mary's point, I mean, the angel's point to Mary is very clear. Luke 1:35 is a precious verse. All the children should memorize that. They should know it exactly. Precisely because of this miracle. Biological miracle is the way to put it. Don't talk about impregnating and all that. That's completely out of the question. The Muslims are horrified by that. We don't mean anything to do with that. A biological miracle was worked in her womb. So then Joseph is very worried about this, right? It's a beautiful story. He's terribly concerned. Wait a minute, she's pregnant. What's gone on here? And then a dream happens in Matthew's version. A dream is given to Joseph. And in the dream, it is said to him, because of this event, you are to understand that that which is yenaod in her, got it? Begotten. The translations go conceived in her. It is a conception, but they're fudging it. It's what the father did there. You see that? That which is a yenaod in her. It's not the birth. There's nothing miraculous about his birth. There's everything miraculous about his begetting by the father, you see? So they fudge the translation a little bit. Most of the translations get it right. That which is begotten, yenaod, brought into existence, caused to come into existence, is from Holy Spirit. It's a new creation, isn't that wonderful? It's a new creation, repeating the Genesis thing. So all this ought to be absolutely common knowledge. I don't think it is yet, that's why we have to go on about it. It should be completely common knowledge. And then people say, my goodness, me, my church teaches that, I'm out of here. That's nonsense. In fact, we were in New Zealand at a Bible study, and some people there from the church were saying at Christmas time, our pastor told us that God became a baby. And he mentioned this fact that a Roman Catholic had said, God came to Mary and said to Mary, will you please be my mother? Quote, you're shaking your head. I love when people say, what? Yes, well, these people were telling this to us in a New Zealand Bible study. And after recounting what the pastor had said, that God came to Mary, or you know, God was going to somehow affect Mary, it was bizarre. They said, immediately said to the pastor, we don't believe a word of that. Well, they hadn't bothered to find out. That's what their church teaches. Anyway, we can do better. We're very technically savvy. We're very information savvy here. We can do better with this. And so it's just nonsense. Yeah.
Just to emphasize the division amongst Orthodox regarding this subject, I'll read a couple of quotes. This is from Calvin, who said that after studying the doctrines of the church, I have thought it better not to touch upon many things, which would be unnecessarily burdensome to the reader.
Yes.
without yielding him any profit. For to what purpose is it to dispute whether the Father is always begetting? For it is foolish to imagine a continual act of generation. So that's Calvin.
He's calling it foolish. Imagine Calvin say it's foolish. You can't attempt to eternally generate.
And then you have this from a modern guy, well-known Walter Martin,
yes.
Who in part says in the kingdom of the cults, which we quote a lot, the scripture nowhere calls Jesus the eternal Son of God. Mm. He's never called Son at all prior to the incarnation, except in prophetic passages.
Right.
Many heresies have seized upon the confusion created by the illogical eternal sonship or eternal generation theory of Roman Catholic theology.
Illogical.
Unfortunately, carried over to some aspects of Protestant theology.
Right. Mm. It's all on the book, so we've got to change that.
Just some comments from the people here online.
Please.
We've got, so you mentioned, I think, Christmas.
Yeah.
And someone says they should change it from the reason is the Trinity.
That's part of the reason.
And then someone else says zillions of people believe this, this eternal, and they think God can do whatever He wants to do, and that's the explanation. Yeah. Period.
That's right.
Another one says for the quote church, Christmas season is when the Trinity is presented in great quantity. And then Randy says it's not a question of whether God can do something, but rather what he actually did.
Good God then, cannot break the rules of language.
Right.
It's not a mystery. If God cannot speak to us clearly, then God is a confuser. That's the problem.
And Michelle says, my point is, they say that if God wants to empty himself, become a fetus, then he can do that. It's a miracle, so no further logical explanation is needed in their mind.
Anyway, the point is made. We don't go on about that. But Paul did say, on questions of days, you know, some people view days differently, allow each other some freedom there to make up their minds. That's perfectly
fair. Although you yourself.
We don't do much with Christmas season because of the rest of the year we spend our time saying that God did not have an eternally begotten son. So why would we suddenly celebrate that? That's where we guided. But we should be very patient with all views in those areas, not like issues of complete adultery and so on. We can't be patient with that, those things. But these are customary things.
Do us a favor, because this week we got some people confused as to this Christmas question when it comes to your person, what you personally do or believe or whatever.
Well, yes.
So
we're following actually what was the custom for 200 years in America. It was illegal to keep Christmas. People don't know. During the time of the Puritans, it was actually illegal, for what it's worth. They sense there was something amiss there. Be that to me. People do what they do, they have a family holiday and so on. So we don't make this, I would never make that the main point of what I'm trying to do.
What are some of the reasons you don't personally...
Well, because I spend the rest of our time saying there is no God the Son who is born. And so why would I celebrate that event? That's really what it celebrates. It celebrates the incarnation, capital I. That means God the Son assumed human nature. Incarnation means he put on impersonal human nature. So the subject of that person, Jesus, is God, dressed up really in human nature. That's got to be wrong. That's
so are you saying that if that wasn't the case, if it was just an observance of the virgin birth, you wouldn't have issues participating?
No. I don't know. It's more obviously historically it doesn't correspond with the literal birth. So our personal choice is sort of leave it alone, comes and goes, and that's the way we do it. And we're very blessed, as Dan was saying earlier, not to be persecuted for that. I mean, we are enjoying incredible freedom, and that may that go on. So everybody make up their own mind. Paul said that in relation to days. Let the person be entirely convinced. If you think that pork is wrong, don't eat it.
That was about the Sabbath, don't that's the Christmas Sabbath. Day.
Yeah, it's rather in the same passage though. Some people observe days, others are fussing about the food laws. Let everybody be convinced in his own mind, and we're convinced at the moment that that's not the best thing for us to do.
Well, just another question. Do you believe that the early Christian church especially, believed or taught that birthdays were in and of themselves pagans.
Yeah, no, I think that's quite wrong. The birthday thing is, I think, making a fuss about nothing. All right, can you keep a wedding anniversary? I think so. Can you celebrate the day you were born? I think so. Jeremiah says, I wish, he's feeling very down, he says, I wish they would curse the day I was born. He said, well, that implies that you can bless the day you're born. I'm not going to fuss about that, but some people want to make that the issue. You know, are you keeping birthdays or not? Well, we can't come to your meetings because you're celebrating a birthday. I'm not convinced that that's an issue. I don't think it's a problem. Now, if on your birthday you suddenly think you're the greatest thing that ever lived, you know, I don't think we do we? I never learned that. A little extra ice cream and a cake, you know. I think our God is greater than that.
You're just in it for the ice cream and the cake.
I'll do it for the cake.
It's all about the food.
It's all about the food. Let everybody be totally convinced. There is a section out there in the public, we should mention, who are terribly concerned about the food laws. And I quote to them Romans 14. Paul says, if you are concerned about the food laws, listen to this, he says, I'm convinced. Paul is a Jew. He's a Christian. I, Paul, am convinced that nothing is unclean of itself unless you think it is. Come on. Is that, do we require an army of exegetes to explain that? He's trying to enforce the food laws in Leviticus 11, and he says, I'm convinced that nothing is unclean. Oh, come on, that's just silly. No, I'm convinced, and I am. If you think pork is a sin, don't have it. We're not going to offer you shrimp if we know you don't like it. Same with very moderate alcohol. It's very clear. That's beautiful freedom to me. And then in the 20th verse of Romans 14, he says, all things are clean. The word there, katharos in Greek, it's the very opposite word of the listed foods there. In Leviticus 11, it says some things are akatharos. They're unclean. Don't touch them. And even the rabbis know that wasn't a health thing. It wasn't that there was something inherently wrong with pork. They learned it as a lesson. They were taught to think of unclean and clean persons, right? So they had these food laws as a discipline. I see that. But it wasn't for reasons of health. Even the rabbis say that. But how much clearer could Paul get in Romans 14? You do Romans 14, verses 14 and 20. I'm convinced, he says, that nothing is unclean of itself unless you think it is. Then a few verses later, all things are katharos, clean. How? I think Jesus would be frightfully frustrated at people who can't understand, but believe me, they don't. They want to fight you to the death on that. Oh, Anthony, you're promoting disobedience and all that. So, we've got a lot of work to do. Okay, we had some people listening. That was fun.
Got music?
Onward Christian Soldiers.
We're going to sing Onward Christian Soldiers. Could we ask Dan to close in prayer for us today? Would you? Sure. That would be lovely.
It's number 413. Number 413.
You want to get up and...